to the cross where your love poured out. Bring me to my knees, Lord, I lay me down. Rid me of myself, I belong to you. Oh, lead me, lead me to.
Welcome to today's Bible teaching with Pastor Mike Bernard of Shoreline Community Church in North Bend, Oregon. We hope you will be blessed as we explore the riches of God's Word verse by verse. Please open your Bible and join us for today's message. Here's Pastor Mike.
Thank you so much for another beautiful Sunday on the lawn. Thank you for providing this great weather. Thank you for an opportunity to come and worship you. Lord, we look forward to what you're going to do here this morning by your Spirit and through your people. I pray, Lord, that you would bless the time of worship. Help us to connect, Lord. Help us to forget about the worries of the week and engage with our Creator this morning, to worship you because you're worthy. I pray, Lord, that you would bless Pastor Mike as he brings your word. Please use it to correct us, to convict us, to comfort us. Whatever it is that we need this morning, you know all about it. So we trust you, Lord, for all of the results. And we offer up our hearts and our lives to you in worship. We thank you again for the cross. Thank you, Lord, for Jesus. Thank you for making a way back home to the Father. It's in Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Well, would you stand with us this morning as we go into worship and one of the great hymns of the church. So if you don't have a lyric sheet, grab one. We have them available, by the way, the lyric sheets.
Even now you are lifting the
sing that again. You heal the brokenhearted. You set the captives free. You lift the heavy burden. And even now you are lifting me. There's no healer. There is no healer like the Lord. Shuffling, we're trying to cope with the wind here. Our God is everlasting. And in that, I love the way Pastor Mike says that, that forever is a really long time. Everlasting and everlasting and everlasting and everlasting, eternity, eternity, eternity. It is amazing. It's hard for me to wrap my mind around that sometimes. We're going to sing about that.
Everlasting God, the everlasting God. as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord. Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer. You are the everlasting God, the everlasting God.
God is so good and faithful.
Oh,
Take that, Lord, to you, dear God. You turn things to good in ways we don't understand sometimes or don't even realize. But God, we thank you for the precious blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. And as we go into the message today, God, that it would just be deep down into our core being, Lord God, that we may live it out, Lord, that we would live our daily life day by day, week by week, month by month, year by year, Lord God, just living for you. We thank you in Jesus' name, amen.
Wasn't that an absolutely beautiful time of worship today? Thank you so much, everyone. Appreciate it. All right. Before we get going, if we've got some of the men around here, some deacons or some elders, over off to my right, I've got several cases of bottled water. If you could go and hand that out to people. And ladies, are you ready for this? I've got all kinds of free chocolate for you as well. So if somebody could take that box of chocolate, it's in little packages, and hand that out, that would be great. So right over in this area here, and I think you'll be blessed by that. Isn't God good? I mean, this is remarkable, the weather that we've had week after week now. Got to say, next week, you know, when you get to the middle of October, you know, you get to that point and the rain's going to come, and we've got like 5 days of rain lined up for next week, so we're going to have to go back indoors. But we're going to be watching for opportunities where we can come back outside again. And so this has just really been a blessing all summer long. Well, we've been working through the book of Ephesians, and today we come to a very critical chapter, because if there's one chapter in the entire Bible that really deals with the Christian marriage, it's this one. And so before we begin, I want to open up in a word of prayer, and then we can begin working our way through here. But Father, thank you so much that we can gather here today to worship you. Lord, you said that you will bless your word, that you will work through it to change our hearts and our lives. And Lord, today I pray that you would work through this word to change our marriages, if that's what has to happen. So God, thank you once again for the incredible love that you've given to us in Christ, and the love that he has for his bride, the church, who are those whom believe. So we thank you, Lord, for this time. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, in 1976, I've been dating Cheryl for 2.5 years, and one day, her father walked up to me, and he said, "Mike," he said, "if you don't hurry up and marry my daughter, I'm going to have a white shotgun with a blue ribbon tied around it at your wedding." True story. He said that to me. We got married. But I'll tell you, times are changing, aren't they? Because today, back in the 70s, that was a big thing. If you're dating somebody for a long time, it's time to get married. And today, it's almost as if people just don't really care. Is marriage really important? And I've got to say, marriage is important. In fact, it's incredibly important. And when marriage is done God's way, there's tremendous blessings that are involved in that. Well, if you knew Cheryl and I today, you probably wouldn't have the same concept of us as back in 1976 when we first got married, because we fought like cats and dogs. You would have looked at this couple, and you would have said of this couple that we would never make it, that this couple did not stand a chance. But then something happened in our lives. Jesus Christ got a hold of us, and we came to Christ. And things began to change, and from that point on, later on this month, we're going to be celebrating our 44th wedding anniversary. Jesus Christ can change lives. Amen? Last week, as we were working through chapter 5 in the book of Ephesians, we ended with this thought in verses 15 through 20. It says, "See then that you walk circumspectly." What that means is that you walk carefully, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time, because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be unwise, but understand what the will of the Lord is. And do not be drunk with wine, which is dissipation. But here's the key thought. But be filled with the Spirit, speaking to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord, giving thanks always for all things to God the Father in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And then we end verse 21 with this statement, submitting to one another in the fear of God. You see, it's important for us to realize that the Spirit-filled life is going to be different than the individual that doesn't have the Spirit. And the Spirit-filled individual is going to have the desire to submit to one another out of reverence for Jesus Christ. We love Christ. We want to serve him. Jesus set the ultimate example for you and me by being the servant himself. And we're to submit to one another. Now, this is critical here in verse 21, because we're getting ready to transition in the book. We're going to transition now into an area that looks at submission. We're going to look at submission of the husband to the wife. We're going to look at submission of the children to the parents. We're going to look at submission to the worker to his employer. And over the next 3 weeks that I teach, I'm going to take each little segment topically, and we're going to look at that particular topic. So anyways, today we're going to begin with that whole concept of marriage. Now, it's important for you and for me to realize that Paul's teachings on marriage were absolutely radical for those who were living in the ancient world. This was a good thing. It was almost as if the wise were slaves. James Montgomery Boyce says this. He says, at the time of Christ, a Jewish woman was not a person, but a thing. Much as black people were regarded as things or property in America before the emancipation. A woman had no legal rights whatever, and a wife could be dismissed at will. It is true that the schools of Shammai and Hillel disagreed with the interpretation of Deuteronomy chapter 24, verse 1, the chief divorce law in Israel. It said that a man could divorce his wife if he found something indecent about her. Shammai said that this meant adultery and adultery alone. Sounds like Jesus, doesn't it? So Shammai seemed to be on the right track here. He said that it meant adultery and adultery alone. Hillel, on the other part, interpreted it as anything that might displease the husband, even spoiling the dinner. In grace, a married woman had no part in a man's life. She was not even a true companion to her husband. She was to run his home and care for his children. A Greek husband was expected to find companionship elsewhere. Wow. How would you ladies like to be involved in a Greek marriage? You take care of the home, you do all the work, you do everything else, and he goes and he finds his companionship elsewhere. And he could dump you for anything. Well, what of Rome? Rome was the sewer of the ancient world. For the first 500 years of the Republic, divorce was unheard of. But at the time of Paul, as Seneca said, women were married to be divorced, and divorced to be married. Martial tells of a woman who had 10 husbands. Juvenal tells of one who had 8 husbands in 5 years. Jerome tells of one Roman matron who was married to her 23rd husband. Sounds almost like Hollywood today, doesn't it? I mean, look at that. But she was married to her 23rd husband, and she was his 21st wife. Sexual perversions were rampant, and profligacy was widespread. And so that's the setting as Paul's writing in the book of Ephesians. And today, a lot of the women especially have a hard time when he starts teaching about submission, but it's a different kind of submission than what was taking place in those days. In fact, his teachings were radical to the point where it was presenting ideas that were so contrary to what was actually happening within the ancient world. Well, Paul's going to begin by giving us 3 examples. I already said, wives, submit to your husbands, children, submit to your parents, and employees or slaves, submit to your masters or employers. And so if you've got your Bible open, I encourage you, Ephesians chapter 5, verse 22. Paul begins and he says this. He says, wives, submit to your own husbands as to the Lord. Well, this passage has gotten many a feminist up in arms. In fact, some have gone on to say so much that the Apostle Paul was a male chauvinist pig, and they just discount him for the teachings in which he said. They look for other reasons to get around it and to get out of it. But in a parallel passage in Colossians chapter 3, verse 18, Paul speaks in a very similar fashion when he says this. He says, wives, submit to your own husbands as is fitting to the Lord. Now, that word submit has become a very offensive word to many ladies today. And the dictionary definition doesn't help the feelings about that at all. In fact, if you were to go to Webster's Dictionary, open it up, look to the word submit, this is what it would say. To give over or yield to the power or authority of another. When I was a young pastor, I was just getting involved in ministry, and I was at a wedding, I was watching what was happening. A very powerful woman walked up to me at that point, and she looked at me, and she said, never use the word submit in your wedding ceremony. And I thought about that. I thought, never use the word submit in your wedding ceremony. It's in the Bible. And anything that's in the Bible is fair game for us to be teaching. In fact, we should teach the whole counsel of God, not what society chooses. Amen?
Amen.
And I got to tell you, since that day, I've used the word submit in every wedding ceremony that I've done, because that's what the Bible tells us to do. William MacDonald says, submission never implies inferiority. The Lord Jesus is submissive to God the Father, but in no way inferior to him. Neither is the woman inferior to the man. In many ways, she is superior in devotedness, in sympathy, in diligence, in heroic endurance. You ever hear of Mama Bear? But wives are commanded to submit to their husbands as to the Lord. In submitting to the authority of her husband, a wife is submitting to the Lord's authority. This in itself should remove any attitude of reluctance or rebellion. You see, submission is a biblical concept. Now back to 21st century America. Here in the United States, we don't like to submit to anything, do we? We don't want to submit to anybody telling us what we need to do. We don't even want to submit today to God and what God says in his word. But if you want to be blessed in your life, the Bible says with obedience come blessing, with disobedience come curse. And so many people today are saying, look, God, I don't want you controlling my life. I want to control my life. And then they come to me when their life is all messed up. Well, the concept of submission brings up a good question. What about the wife who's married to an unbeliever? In 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 14 through 15, the Apostle Paul said this. He said, do not be unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship has righteousness with lawlessness? And what communion has light with darkness? And what accord has Christ with Belial? Or what part as a believer with an unbeliever? Now, as Christians, we're really quick to take that passage and say, that is for marriages. And it is, in a certain sense. But I'm going to say that that passage goes far further than just marriages. That passage deals with every aspect of our life. You see, because we need to be right with God. It's very hard to be right with God if you become equally yoked with somebody who doesn't believe in God, somebody who doesn't want to operate by the standards of God. And in the marriage, when Paul writes this, and I'm just going to apply it to the marriage here. When Paul writes this in regards to marriage, he's saying, look, you can avoid a whole lot of problems in your marriage if you're equally yoked, if you're doing this together, if you're pulling together. You get the imagery here of two oxen, right? Two oxen. You've got them yoked together with this board across their neck. And you've got the picture here that one of the oxen is pulling and the other oxen is not, is resisting. What would happen? You'd just be going around in circles. And maybe some of you feel that way in your marriage right now when you're not equally yoked with your spouse. They don't have the same view of Christ that you have. And you just feel like you're just spinning your wheels. You're just going in circles. You're not getting anywhere. The Apostle Paul here is trying to keep people from having a lot of unnecessary strife in their life. But what about it when you're married to an unbeliever, somebody who doesn't believe in Jesus Christ? And by the way, I don't know how many times I've seen where people have gone through premarital counseling and you've got one believer, one person who's questionable, that person, for the sake of the marriage, is saying, I'm a believer. And then after the wedding takes place, that individual begins backing off. And so, gentlemen and ladies, I would say before you marry anyone, make sure that they truly are a believer in Jesus Christ so that you can go forward equally yoked, which means that with that yoke across your neck, both of you are pulling together through life. It makes it so much easier when you're not spinning in circles. So what about that unbelieving husband or that unbelieving wife? Should the unbelieving wife... Should the believing wife submit to the unbelieving husband? And the answer is yes. Unless he commands her to do something that God forbids, or he forbids her to do something that God commands. Well, what would that be? I don't want you going to church. I don't want you going to Bible study. I want you to stay home. Then you got a problem, don't you? Because God says, do not forsake the assembling together. And those are the kind of issues that can pop up in this situation. So how should a Christian woman relate to her unbelieving husband? Well, Peter t- tells us in 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 1 through 2. He says, "Wives, in the same way, be submissive to your husbands, so that if any of them do not believe the word, they may be won over without the words or the behavior of the wives when they see the purity and the reverence of your life." So what do you do if you're already married to somebody who's not a believer? Well, you continue to be married, and you set the example of what a Christian should be like. And as they look at you, as they see the changes that are taking place in your life, hopefully God's at work in their life and will eventually bring them to faith in Christ. But there's no guarantee. And it should be the same way with husbands, even with unbelieving wives, that you set the example. I tell people quite often in counseling, you can't change the other person, but you can change yourself. And when you change yourself so that you become more Christ-like, then they're getting a better picture of what it's like to be a Christian, and God can be at work through that. But if you're fighting them all the time, then it's so much harder to reach them for Christ. So the believing spouse should set the example for the unbelieving spouse in the way in which they live their lives. Now, I think it's important for you and me to remember that God has an order of relationships in our lives. There's a priority in the order. Who should be number one in our lives? God. God is always number one in our lives as a Christian. Who should be number two in our lives? It should be our spouse. It should be our husband. It should be our wife, whoever it is that we're married to. Who should be number three in our lives? It should be our children, right? We're given that responsibility. God, spouse, children, and then underneath that comes everything else. And it's so easy to get those things mixed up. And sometimes, even within the marriage relationship, the children get it raised up above the husband or above the wife. And you can bet that you're going to have marriage problems when that happens. You get out of God's orders, right, or God's order, and things happen. Verse 23. "For the husband is the head of the wife, as also Christ is the head of the church, and he is the Savior of the body. This is God's order in creation. But God in his sovereignty has ordained for Christian husbands to be the spiritual leaders of the family." Say, "Oh, wait a minute. In my marriage, it's the woman, you know, who's the spiritual one," or whatever it might be. "But God has ordained that men be the spiritual leaders of the family." You say, why? Why in the world would he ever do that? And we get the answer in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 8 through 9. "For man is not from woman, but woman from man. Nor was man created for woman, but woman for the man." Just following creation, we see in the garden that God goes ahead and he creates Adam out of the dust of the ground. And he breathes into his nostrils the breath of life. And he puts him within this perfect environment, the Garden of Eden, in which he's to tend the garden. But he notices that something is not good. And what was not good was that Adam needed a companion. He found no suitable companion for him. And so out of the ground, the Lord formed every beast of the field, the birds of the air, but there was no suitable helper. And so in Genesis chapter 2, verses 21 through 22, we see the Bible says, "And the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall on Adam, and he slept, and he took one of his ribs, and he closed up the flesh in its place. Then the rib which the Lord God had taken from the man, he made into a woman, and he brought her to him." Verse 23 continues, "And Adam said, this is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, because she was taken out of man." Adam's put in the garden. God goes ahead, he creates the animals. He tells Adam, "You're going to go ahead and name these." One by one, they start coming to him, and he looks and he sees the horse. He says, "Oh, mine, that's an incredible looking animal. I'm going to call him a horse." And then he sees a chicken walking along, and he says, "Well, I'm going to call that a chicken." And he sees this beautiful giraffe walking along with the big neck. "I'm going to call that a giraffe." But no suitable helper was found. And then here comes Eve. Adam took one look at Eve. And you know what he said? "Whoa, man. And from that day on, you guys have been called woman. That's how it goes. That's right. So anyways, but interestingly enough, after Eve comes on the scene, it wasn't Adam whom the serpent went after, it was Eve, it was his wife. And I think we'll be talking a little more about this when we get to our children in a couple of weeks here. But I think we'll find that the enemy has a way of going after the weakest link in the family. Amen? He's going to look for that weak link. And in this particular case, he didn't go to Adam who God had spoken to. Adam had been spoken to by God. He had been told that he wasn't to eat from any of the fruit in the garden. He could eat from any of the fruit in the garden with the exception of the fruit that was in the middle of that garden. And so Eve is the one who the enemy ends up going after. We see that in Genesis chapter 3, verses 1 through 4. Now the serpent was more cunning than any beast in the field which the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, "Has God indeed said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden?" And the woman said to the serpent, "We may eat the fruit of the trees of the garden, but not the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden. God has said, you shall not eat it, nor shall you touch it, lest you die." Then the serpent said to the woman, "You will not surely die, for God knows that in the day of it that you eat, your eyes will be open, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." Did you catch what the serpent does there? Comes up to Eve. Did God really say? And I think even today we end up wrestling with that sometimes as we begin to question the teachings that are in God's Word. And the enemy will come up and say, "Is that what God really said? Is that what God really meant?" And when Satan came up there and he did that to Eve, do you know what he was saying? He was saying, "Eve, don't you realize that God is withholding his best from you?" Next time, she goes out. She gets the fruit. She bites. She begins to eat. You would think that when Adam heard about that, especially since God had spoken to Adam, that Adam would have corrected her on the spot and would have tried to have made the situation right with God. Amen? But he didn't. As soon as she eats, she offers it to her husband. And instead of correcting her, he takes the fruit and he eats. And at that moment, you see the fall of man. You see that mankind died spiritually at that moment. Mankind was in desperate need of a Savior from that point. And we've all been messed up from that time. Well, it's important for us to realize that the wife is in no way inferior to her husband. In fact, in Genesis chapter 1, verse 27, it says, "In the image of God, he made them male and female." Many are quick to point out, I'll wait for the helicopter here for a second. Many are quick to point to Galatians chapter 3, verses 28 through 29, to prove that women are equal to men in all things, including their roles. In Galatians chapter 3, verses 28 and 29, the Apostle Paul writes this. He says, "There is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither slave nor free, there is neither male nor female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. If you are Christ, then you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise." The people look at that and say, look, you've got the restrictions in the Old Testament, but when we get to the New Testament, everybody is one. We are all one in Christ. And what I've got to say on that is you need to look at the scriptures in the context in which they're at. Let's go ahead and go back a couple of verses, because it says this, Galatians chapter 3, verses 26 through 27, "For you are all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus. For as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ." You see, in this particular passage, men and women are absolutely the same when it comes to salvation. We're all saved by grace through faith in Jesus Christ alone. But where we're different is in that role that God gave to each and every one of us. He's called men to be the spiritual leaders of the family, He's called women to submit to their wives or to their husbands, to respect their husbands. Let's see, verse 24 says, therefore, just as the church is subject to Christ, so let wives be subject to their own husbands in everything. Now, we need to have a little clarification here. If a husband comes out and tells his wife to do something that's contrary to the word of God, is that wife to be subject in that, to do that? And I would have to say no. Jesus would never ask his bride, his church, to do something that's contrary to the word of God. And when we look at submission, the ultimate picture of submission in the Bible is that of the Holy Trinity. We as Christians believe in one God revealed in three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. They are equal in essence. They are equal in their deity. But what's the difference? Their difference in the role. You see, the Father being supreme in role within the Trinity, in which he sends his Son to be the Savior of the world. Jesus willingly goes to the earth, lives his life, dies on the cross to redeem us from our sins. You see that the Holy Spirit is sent by the Father and by the Son, and it's the Holy Spirit who regenerates and who seals, and each and every one of them have a role. And so the beautiful picture to look at, the ultimate picture of this concept of willing submission, is that of the church. You know, just when it looks like, in fact, let me back off a little bit. In fact, it says, but now you're probably thinking, well, the husband's got the better deal on this whole thing. You know, I mean, the wife's told here to submit, so he's got the better deal, until you see that God comes along with the command here through Paul that should set every husband back on their heels. Verse 25, husbands, love your wives, just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for her. Well, what does that mean? You see, the emphasis here is not on the husband's authority to govern. The emphasis here that Paul has given is on the husband's call to love his wife and to be willing to give his life for his wife. We think that the husband's got the easy part until you realize that Paul devotes three times more space to dealing with the responsibility of the husband than he does of the responsibility of the wife. And just when it looks like the husband's got it made, Paul raises the bar to an extremely high level. You see, the wife is commanded to submit to her husband, but the husband is commanded to love his wife so much that he dies for her. The wife gets to submit. The husband gets to die. You see the difference on here? That's how much Jesus loves his bride, the church. You see, submission in a marriage would be no problems if the husbands would treat their wives as Christ treats the church. In Mark chapter 10, verses 43 through 45, Mark writes this. He said, whoever desires to become great among you, this is Jesus speaking, whoever desires to become great among you shall be your servant. And whoever of you desires to be first shall be slave of all. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom. The disciples are arguing over who's the greatest. And Jesus turns it around, doesn't he? He said, look, I didn't come to be served. If anyone who could have ever come to the earth could have come to be served, it would have been Jesus. He's Lord, right? I didn't come to be served. I came to serve and to give my life as a ransom. I thought that was particularly interesting that when I look back earlier in that chapter, you want to guess what the topic was that they were dealing with? Divorce. It was divorce. Now Jesus has turned it around and he says this. I am stunned at the number of Christian divorces that we have in this country. If statistics hold true, one out of every two Christian marriages ends in divorce. How can that be? I mean, how have we gotten to that point in which one out of two, 50% of Christian marriages end in divorce? In Malachi chapter 2, verse 16, Malachi writes this. He said, for the Lord God of Israel says he hates divorce. That alone ought to be enough for us to think twice before we jump into it, realizing that God himself hates divorce. But I'm afraid that today there's no fear of God. We're Americans. We do what we want to do. But do we look at the Word of God? Do we look at what God has to say about this whole topic of divorce? In the New Testament, we find only two exception clauses allowing for divorce. The first one comes from Jesus in Matthew chapter 5, verses 31 through 32. Jesus said, "Furthermore, it has been said, whoever divorces his wife, let him give her a certificate of divorce. But I say to you that whoever divorces his wife for any reason except sexual immorality causes her to commit adultery, and whoever marries a woman who is divorced commits adultery." Now, when we see that exception clause that comes from Jesus, whoever divorces his wife for any reason except sexual immorality, do you know what the Greek word is for sexual immorality? Porneia. Did you catch that? Porneia. What does that sound like? Pornography. You know, pornography is devastating marriages all over the place today. It was not just the men. 70% of Christian men are involved in pornography. But the amazing thing to me is 30% of Christian women are involved in pornography. And you wonder, how can Christian women be involved in pornography? And here's the answer. It's not so much visual for the ladies, but they'll read the romance novels and the different things that are emotional. Where for the men, it's visual. But here's the thing. Pornography, guys, is not fair for your wife. Pornography, pornographic material, is a lie. And it's not fair. The wife can never measure up. She can't Photoshop herself before she comes to you. She's going to end up getting older as time goes by. She's going to end up getting gray hair and wrinkles and more weight because that's what happens in life. And they come with this lie with Photoshop pictures that they put in front of you of a picture that never has a bad day, a picture that you never have a problem with, a picture that never argues back with you. And I'll tell you what, guys, it messes with your mind and it messes with your marriage. And there's one solution. Okay, there's absolutely one solution. You got to cut it. You can't play with it. You can't toy with it. You got to cut it. Because if you toy with it, it will snag you. That's Satan. He'll go ahead and he will get you. Treat your wife as the gift that God has given to you. You see, Paul gives us another exception clause in 1 Corinthians chapter 7, and that's abandonment. 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verses 10 through 12, he writes this. He says, "Now to the married I command, yet not I, but the Lord. A wife is not to depart from her husband. But even if she does depart, let her remain unmarried or be reconciled to her husband. And the husband is not to divorce his wife, but to the rest I, not the Lord, say this. If any brother has a wife who does not believe, and she is willing to live with him, let him not divorce her." So here's the thing. You're unequally yoked. You've got one partner who's a Christian, one partner who's not. You're going through all of these problems in your marriage, and sometimes maybe you wish they would just go. But what Paul is saying is if that spouse wants to stay with you, you stay with them because there's always that chance to lead them to Christ. But then in verse 15, he continues and he says, "But if the unbeliever departs, let him depart. A brother or a sister is not under bondage in such cases. But God has called us to peace." So here's the thing. Okay, this isn't an excuse for you to go out and make your spouse, your unbelieving spouse, miserable so that they leave. But if they do choose to leave, you're not bound. And here's the other thing, too. You can go back to the exception clause Jesus gives about sexual immorality. What I tell people when I'm counseling them after something like that has happened, even though it's happened, you are not obligated to leave that spouse. What I tell the violated spouse is this. You are in the driver's seat at this point. You know, you're not told to leave, but now you've got the exception clause in which you've been cheated on, you've been violated on. Now it's in your ballpark to make that decision. But I have seen in the past individuals who have gone out and they've fallen into relationships and they've been called for church discipline over that, and their marriage has been completely restored. So, you know, don't be so quick to run out when something happens, but you do have that right should that happen. But if the unbeliever departs, it says, let him depart. It's okay, but it doesn't say anything in this passage about remarriage. I've had so many people talk to me over the years that come to me, and as a pastor, they want me to justify the divorce that they want to have. And I listen to their story, and they don't have the biblical backgrounds for divorce. And they can't believe that I won't say, go ahead and get divorced. I think we need to be careful. In our country, we do what we want to do, and we're far too quick to run out of our obligations and the commitments that we make. Today, Christian marriage is under attack like never before. In fact, gay marriage is being forced down upon us as this is okay when God's word says that it's not okay. Things have gotten so tough when it comes to Christian marriage that our elders got together and we decided that we had to add another statement into our church statement of faith. And this is what we added. We believe that marriage is ordained by God to be between one man and one woman. Why would we add those words? Because society is telling us that's not what marriage is today. But that's what the Bible says marriage is. That's Genesis chapter 2, verses 23 through 24. We believe that marriage is ordained of God to be between one man and one woman. God's design for marriage is that it lasts for a lifetime. Amen. Amen? You might be thinking right now, I've been divorced. What does that mean for me? First of all, if you were the one who was in the wrong in the divorce, and you may be here and you may be the one who was violated, and you're totally fine on that, but if you were the one who was in the wrong on divorce, then I would say go to 1 John 1:9, that if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us of all unrighteousness. And if you're involved in a second marriage right now, then what I would say is to do your best in your current marriage that it be done right and to the best of your ability in Christ, to do it in Christ as a Christian marriage. You know, we can't change our past sometimes, but we can change our future, can't we? I was looking online and I recently found 9 tips that were very good for having a better relationship. Tip number 1 is communicate. I think as husbands and wives, we need to spend time talking, and that's one of the biggest difficulties that we have. We get so busy, we don't have time to get together and to talk. But try to find that time, even if it's a date in which you go out one time a week to talk. Number 2, don't assume something, but ask your husband or wife for clarification before getting angry if something's happened. Is that what you really said? Is that what you really meant? Number 3, don't yell. What happens when you yell? It's like a match. If you light a match here and you've got that match burning away in your hand, and if you leave it with just the one match, it's going to just burn out really quickly. But if you light the one match here and it's burning away, now the other person's mad, they light the other match, and you put them together, you got a torch going off, right? Back down a little bit. Don't yell. Proverbs 15:1 says, a soft answer turns away wrath, but a harsh word stirs up anger. Another one is listen. We sometimes just need to simply shut up and stop talking and listening to what our husband or our wife is saying. Number 5, let your husband or your wife finish talking before you cut them off. Number 6, keep your hands to yourself. Never become physical in marriage, in the sense of violence, pushing, whatever it might be. Keep your hands to yourself. Number 7, don't disrespect the other. We see that to respect is a command from God, and to disrespect is to dishonor. Number 8, apologize when you're wrong. When you know that you're wrong, ask for forgiveness. Number 9, be honest, yet be sensitive as you communicate to your husband and your wife. And do the best that you can so that you can come to communications. I think 9 times out of 10,
arguments that happen are because some miscommunication happened somewhere along the line. Verse 26, that he, meaning Christ, might sanctify and cleanse her with the washing of the water of the word. This, of course, is talking about the church, but it also refers to our marriages. Now, as we look at verse 26, take a look at this and notice that it's Jesus who sanctifies his bride. And he, meaning Christ, might sanctify and cleanse her with the washing of the water of the word. In Titus chapter 3, verses 5 through 7, Paul wrote, "Not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy he saved us through the washing of regeneration and the renewal of the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us abundantly through Jesus Christ our Savior, that having been justified by his grace, we should become heirs according to the hope of eternal life." Jesus takes his bride and he cleanses her. And gentlemen, for us who are called to be the spiritual leaders in our families as Christians, we're responsible before God for cleansing our wives. And part of that is through washing with the water of the word, because the word of God changes us from the inside out. Amen? There's an important point for us to see here. It's God's will that the husband be the spiritual leader of the Christian family. And in doing so, we should use words that build up and not tear down. Verse 27, that he might present her to himself as a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that he should be holy and without blemish. That she should be, let me back up, that I read that wrong, sorry. That he might present her to himself as a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she should be holy and without blemish. I have to laugh at what Cheryl says. She goes, you know, God is so awesome. Haven't you noticed that as we get older, our vision fades so that we can't see as clearly? And we can't see our wrinkles anymore, can we? We can't see some of the blemishes. And that's how it should get for us in our marriage relationships. As we get older, we get closer, and we don't see all of the blemishes, that we still look beautiful to each other. Well, a marriage relationship should become more and more beautiful with age and maturity, and hard times are inevitably going to come. We go through different seasons of life. It'd be great if when we're young, everything stays nice, everybody stays healthy, the kids are well behaved, everything else is going on. But times change as we grow in our life, don't they? And those trials of life are going to inevitably come. And how we deal with those trials of life are either going to make our marriage or they're going to break our marriage. The thing to do is to come together in unity as we work through some of these difficult times. One of your biggest challenges, and yet one of your biggest blessings, is going to be the raising of your children. And over again, you've heard me say, I believe that God gave us children to teach us to pray. Can you say amen to that one? Yeah, I think each and every one of us have gone through challenges in that way. Well, in verse 27, Paul writes and he says that he might present her to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she should be holy and without blemish. And the imagery here is that as Christ comes to the wedding supper of the Lamb, that he presents his bride beautifully, holy, without blemish. John Stott says this. He calls this the eschatological, excuse me. He calls this the eschatological dimension, that is the end product when the church shall appear before God in perfection. Just so, he says, a husband should never use his headship to crush or to stifle his wife or to frustrate her from being himself. His love for her will lead him to an exactly opposite path. He will give himself up for her in order that she may develop her full potential under God and so become completely herself. In other words, the husband who loves his wife like Christ loves the church will continue to develop that wife into Christ likeness. She will become absolutely beautiful over time, and with age will increase in that beauty. And that inner beauty and holiness will continue into heaven for all eternity. You see, the Christian wife is on her way to becoming
a dazzlingly beautiful in her glorified resurrection body. Isn't that neat? Stop, think about that for a moment. God has given that responsibility, guys, that we are to help our wives develop, and one of these days they're going to go to heaven, have that glorified body, and they're doing that just like Christ sanctified the church. We're called as husbands to love our wives and to help them to grow in their faith. But Paul continues in verses 28 and 29, so husbands ought to love their own wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself, for no one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it, just as the Lord does the church. William MacDonald says, man is born with the instinct to care for his own body. He feeds, he clothes, he bathes it, he protects it from discomfort, pain, and harm. And the same should be true of the Christian husband who's taking care of his wife. He should care for her. He should feed her. He should provide clothes for her. He should protect her. And you see, if your body is physically sick, you know it. And if your marriage is sick, you know that too, don't you? Now, verse 30 continues and says, for we are members of his body, his flesh, and his bones. And we see a beautiful picture here of unity with each other, unity with Christ. One of the incredible truths about marriage is this. It's a mathematical truth. 1 × 1 × 1 = what? It's equal to 3. 1 × 1 × 1 = 1. And this is the truth of the union with Christ. In fact, in Ecclesiastes 4:12, it says, though one may be overpowered by another, two can withstand him, and a threefold cord is not easily broken. That threefold cord is a picture of the Christian marriage. You've got God, you've got the husband, you've got the wife, you've got them intertwined together. And as the storms of life come, you're much stronger when you're in God, and you can get through those times. Verse 31 continues, for this reason, a man shall leave his father and his mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. The two become united in marriage. And you see, this commandment originated at creation. And after God went ahead, he ends up putting Adam into that deep sleep that we talked about. He took a rib out. He ends up creating Eve from that rib. And then Adam finally awakes. And Adam says this. He says, now, this is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and his mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. Now, we hear that at every marriage ceremony. But I think it's interesting that when it happened to Adam and Eve in the garden, they didn't have in-laws, did they? This is something that we deal with today. But therefore, a man shall leave his father and his mother, be joined to the wife, and they shall become one flesh. And in many marriages today, in fact, too many, people have trouble with parents. People have trouble with in-laws. And you have to leave, and you've got a new relationship. You've got a new focus as you move forward together. Jesus confirms Moses' comments in Genesis chapter 2, verse 24, in Matthew chapter 19, verses 3 through 6. Jesus said this, the Pharisees are also came to him. Matthew said that. The Pharisees also came to him, Jesus, testing him and saying to him, is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife for just any reason? And he answered, and he said to them, have you not read that he who made them at the beginning made them male and female, and said, for this reason a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So then, they are no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let man not separate. And this is a beautiful picture of the special union between Christ and his bride, the church. And I wonder how many of us actually realize how special of a union that is. How many of you have been to a wedding ceremony before? A lot of you out there? All right. When you're at the church, you're at the wedding ceremony, usually what you have, if the altar is up here, you've got the man's family sitting on this side. You've got the woman's family sitting on that side. And so now when everybody's being seated, you've got the groomsmen
They'll come on down. The men will hold the ladies by the left, by their left arm, and they will walk down and they will seat them. But there is a change that happens. If in fact the groom ends up walking his mother down the aisle, the groom will take the mother by the right hand, and he will walk her down the aisle, because up until that point, she is the one who is in the prominent place, the woman who is in the prominent place in his life. So he walks her down and he sits on the aisle, and then, or she sits in her seat, and then he goes over to his position in order to do the wedding ceremony. Now, as I said, as they're walking down the aisle, the men have the ladies by their left hand here, and they walk down and they seat them. But when it comes time for the father to bring the bride down, notice that the father will have the bride on the right side, because the bride, up until that point, her father is in that position of prominence in her life, okay? And so they walk on down, and the father kisses the bride. She goes ahead and gets at her position over here, and the marriage ceremony begins. Now, you've got the groom on this side, and once the vows are exchanged, and the wedding's over, and they go ahead and they kiss the bride, and they prepare to walk down the aisle, what has just happened? You see, the bride's on this side. Now, where the father before had that position of honor, now the new husband who's just taken his bride spins, and now she is on his right side, the position of honor. And you see this transfer, beautiful picture of the transfer in that special place of honor, that special place of prominence that the bride now has. What a beautiful picture that is of what Christ has done for us at salvation. Because at salvation, we're placed in that special place of honor. We're placed in that special place of prominence in Christ. You see, God created marriage to illustrate the relationship between Christ and the church. And as we look at verse 32, it says, "This is a great mystery, but I speak concerning Christ and the church." You see, Christ's relationship with his bride, the church, is the ultimate picture of what marriage should be. Now, if you have a perfect marriage, I want to know it, because you need to be teaching a marriage class here. Because marriage is hard work. Marriage is something that we have to work through. You've got two very different people that come together to become one. And yet we can gradually grow together over time. It gets kind of scary when you go out for dinner and you're eating the same things. You get the recipes and you eat the same orders. Well, Christ the groom died. He rose again so that the bride, who is us, could live life to the full. And verse 33 continues and says, "Nevertheless, let each one of you in particular so love his wife as himself. And let the wife see that she respects her husband." Every marriage ceremony that I do, I like to run some people through. I like to run the couples through little things, little tips that they can do to be strong in the Lord and strong with each other. And so here you go. It is having God at the center of your marriage. It is spending time in God's word and praying with and for each other every day. It is kissing regularly and remembering to say "I love you" several times a day, really meaning it. It is always leaving the communication channels open and never going to sleep angry at night. It is never being told, too old to hold hands or to cultivate romance. It is trusting God and trusting each other completely. It is having the Lord Jesus Christ as the anchor of your souls during the storms of life which inevitably come. And then using those experiences to become even stronger together as a couple. It is having the capacity to forgive, and this is important, to forget. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 21 says, "Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other just as in Christ God forgave you." As you look back over the course of your life, how many times has the Lord forgiven you for one thing or another? How many times have you had to ask the Lord to forgive you? He does. Are we willing to do that with our spouse? It is the continuous process of growing as each other's best friends for the rest of your life. It is not only marrying the right partner, it is being the right partner. Charles Spurgeon said, "The true Christian husband ought to be to his wife as Christ is to
to his church. And if the true Christian husband loved his wife as Christ loved the church, I don't think we would have any problem with the woman submitting to their husbands. I think that would be something that they would want to do. To have a godly marriage, it's no piece of cake. To have a godly marriage requires hard work. It requires commitment from both parties. But marriage that's done God's way can be a little taste of heaven on earth today. Amen? Let's pray. Lord, thank you for your word. And another tough teaching here, but what a beautiful thing, Lord, that the relationship between you, Jesus, and the church is a picture of what our marriage should be. Lord, each and every one of us make mistakes. Each and every one of us have areas that we need to grow. And I pray that this message today would be a challenge to all of us, Lord, that we might become more like Christ, that husbands might love their wives as Christ loves the church, that wives might submit to their husbands and respect them in the sense of honoring them in the position that you, God, have given to them. And Lord, we're also told that we're not to be unequally yoked, and some of us are in challenging situations, and I just pray for wisdom in each and every one of those, that through acting in a Christ-like way, that people would come, their spouses would come to faith in Christ. Lord, if there's anyone here today who's never received Jesus as their Savior, I pray that they wouldn't leave here today without doing so. Lord, that they would acknowledge that they are sinners in need of a Savior. Lord, that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Lord, as they confess that they believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, that you died for their sins, Lord, I pray that they would receive you as Savior and Lord and put their trust and their hope in you for the rest of their lives, for all eternity. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let's stand and go out rejoicing. This morning, it is so good to see all of you. We're going to close with love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength.
I will pray.
just a few announcements before we go ahead and close. I wanted to remind you, we've got the Operation Christmas Child shoeboxes over there if you'd like to help some overseas children who are in need. Also, we've got the communication sheets by the offering boxes up front here, and Country Gospel Jubilee this afternoon. In fact, there's a buddy. He's going to be, what do you call that instrument?
Hammer dulcimer.
A hammer dulcimer. If you've never heard a hammer dulcimer, Buddy's going to be doing that this afternoon at 3 o'clock here on the lawn. Also, Cheryl and I are going to be leaving on vacation, yay, as of today, right? So we're going to be leaving on vacation. Pastor Shea will be preaching next week. I looked on my phone. We've got 5 days of rain that are lined up, so we will be back in the building next week. Services, normal time, 8:30, 11 o'clock. The elders are still talking on this, but I think what we'll do, we'd like to continue meeting outside as long as we can. Have you guys enjoyed this? This is awesome. I mean, we can breathe. We don't have to wear masks, all that kind of stuff. This is awesome. So we're going to be watching every week to see how the weather is. And if we can meet outside, then what we'll do, so we're not switching times all over the place, is we will meet at 11 o'clock outside, and we'll let the church know on those days that we can do that. That way, every week, we've got service at 8:30, 11. If we're outside, we'll cancel the 8:30 and just meet out here. So if that's good with you guys, it's been an awesome day. It hasn't been an awesome summer as we've been out here. I just absolutely love this. We're looking forward to doing this next year. We're hoping to continue doing this in the future. Let's close in a word of prayer. And Father, thank you for this time once again that we can gather here. And Lord, I so appreciate this church body. I so appreciate the love and just incredible fellowship that is here. Lord, thank you for a summer of incredible weather outside. And we look forward, even in the days to come, Lord, what you're going to do with this church. We want to honor you in every aspect. And Lord, I pray that we would look at this community with your eyes and see that you've called us to reach this community for you. So thank you. We praise you. We love you in Jesus' name. Amen. Just one final thing. As we go back in the sanctuary, when you see it, that is not the final product, okay? We're still working. We've got a long way to go. When we get done, it'll be beautiful, but we're not there yet. So when you go back in, just please realize it's a work in progress. God bless you guys.